So in the last lecture, we discussed that how exchange rate is can pose a problem for the Indian exporters. We discussed that basically without any change in the nominal exchange rate, the real exchange rate gets appreciated. One reason we discussed was the high rate of inflation that is going on in India as compared to other countries. This high inflation is leading to appreciation of real exchange rate. And second reason, and when the real exchange rate will appreciate, what will happen? Our exports will become less competitive. They will become more costly. And second reason, what the challenge before the exporting community is the quantitative easing that was taking place in the US for the last 7-8 years that was artificially depreciating dollars vis-a-vis other currencies. That has also adversely impacted our exports because the vis-a-vis dollar, Indian currency will also artificially appreciate. So basically these were the twin challenges before the exporting community that basically we have to see. Moreover, in Eurozone also now they are starting the quantitative easing. So this same process, the Euro will also artificially depreciate. That will make our exports to Europe also quite difficult. So that is what we discussed in the last lecture. Now, on the domestic front, there are certain challenges that need to be addressed. Basically, some findings done by Center for WTO Studies. There is a Center for WTO Studies. It has made some findings that these can pose challenges on the domestic front. So what are these challenges that have been pointed out by Center for WTO Studies? These challenges, first, telecom and information technology infrastructure have increasingly become important in the process of trade. Now in India, the penetration of internet is so low as compared to our competitors that this can pose a problem for India's trade prospects. The Center for WTO Studies says that this telecom and IT infrastructure is must in the process of trade. And in India, the internet use remains extremely low as compared to some other of our competitors, which are at the same level of development. As compared to them, the internet penetration in India is low. One is this challenge, because now use of technology, information and technology is becoming more and more important in facilitating trade. Second, India does not have uniform system of indirect taxation. In India, GST, goods and services tax, has not been implemented as of yet. So as a result, in the absence of uniform system of indirect taxation in India, what happens? Exporters are often unable to get rebate on all indirect taxes that they pay on exported commodities. Because of lack of uniform system of indirect taxation, exporters often are unable to get rebate on all the indirect taxes that they have paid while manufacturing a commodity which they are exporting. The various inputs that they are using for manufacturing a commodity, on every input they are paying indirect taxes. As a result, the final value of the goods produced by them, its price increase. As a result of this price increase, the export competitiveness decreases. This is the cascading effect of tax, which will be eliminated once GST is implemented. Once goods and services tax comes into existence, this cascading impact of tax will go, and that will make our goods more competitive. Basically, because of number of taxes that they pay on the inputs used, that the cost of the price of the final commodity is significantly enhanced. As a result, this results in their commodities being less competitive. So GST, which is to be implemented, is expected to help India's exporting community significantly. This will not only eliminate the cascading effect of tax, this will bring about simplification and harmonization of indirect tax regime of the country, which will reduce the cost of production. That this reduced cost of production will make India's goods more competitive vis-a-vis other countries. So this is very important. Third part is labor. In India, we have very rigid labor laws. This rigid labor laws, neither they help the labor nor they help the manufacturing community. Because of rigid labor laws, once you hire a labor, it is very difficult to fire him. So what do the manufacturing community do? They hire the labor on contractual basis. As a result, the unorganized labor force is more. The organized labor force is less. Why? Because if they hire a labor on permanent basis, they cannot fire them because of rigid labor laws. So this acts as a deterrent for this manufacturing community to hire a labor on a permanent basis, and therefore the organized workforce is less. And basically, when a labor is hired on contractual basis, he does not have any social security benefits. So basically, labor regulation plays a very critical role in determining trade and investment. Now, these labor laws need to be simplified, they need to be rationalized, they need to be liberalized. There is need, and recent initiative by the central government and of some of the state government towards liberalization, rationalization and simplification of labor laws must be taken to their logical end, so that the labor laws become simple. Like just like in SEZ. In SEZ's labor laws don't apply. As a result, they don't have any problem in hiring the organized labor. So basically, this simplification in labor laws that have been initiated in some of the state government and central government has also initiated this, they must be taken to the logical end. Basically, in order to make Indian labor more productive and efficient, which will contribute to enhancing the global competitiveness of India's products. Once the labor laws are simplified, it will be beneficial both for the industry and labor, and they will mutually gain from this process, and ultimately the entire country would reap the benefit by way of competitive goods. The trade policy statement, these are the three challenges that were put forward by Center for WTO Studies, that these domestic changes need to be accomplished. The trade policy statement states that in the previous years, or in the past foreign trade policies, we have been focusing on market diversification as well as product diversification. That is, we were searching for different markets where we can export our commodities, and side by side we were also diversifying the commodity range. We were trying to diversify our products. This process of market diversification has helped India to maintain its exports even during the global slowdown. So the present foreign trade policy states that since this market diversification has stood in India's good stead during the global economic downturn, this market diversification strategy will continue to be a key determinant of country's trade policy, together with product diversification. Both market diversification and product diversification will continue in the existing trade policy because they have yielded beneficial results in the past. Now, there is a clear recognition within the government that exports should not merely be a function of marketable surplus. That is, export, what do we usually used to do previously? Whatever surplus that remains behind, that needs to be exported. No, we need to manufacture for export. The foreign trade policy clearly recognizes that export should not merely be a function of marketable surplus, but should reflect a genuine enhancement in economic capacity. That is, foreign trade policy must enhance the India's manufacturing prowess so that we manufacture for export. Through its foreign trade policy, government envisages following objectives. There are few objectives of the foreign trade policy. First is employment creation. See, some of the sectors are labor intensive. There are like a textile sector. If the export of textile increases, because textile is labor intensive industry and certain industries are capital intensive. Textile is a labor, leather, textile, these are labor intensive, gems and jewelry, these are labor intensive industries. When the export of such sectors increase, it creates further employment. So the foreign trade policy states employment creation in both manufacturing and services. Through the generation of foreign trade opportunities, we will generate opportunities for trade, and as a result of increased trade, increased manufacturing will take place and increased employment will take place. So employment will increase. Second, the foreign trade policy puts forward emphasis towards a stable agricultural policy. Basically, in our country, this agriculture commodities vis-a-vis export, this policy has been fluctuating. At times, we ban the export of particular agriculture goods. At times, we promote the export. So what happens? This hampers the trading environment. You should have a stable, fairly stable agricultural policy. So this foreign trade policy emphasizes on a stable agricultural trade policy that encourages the import of raw material. Encouraging the import of raw material wherever required and export of processed goods. Now we are emphasizing on value addition. That is, whatever we are exporting, that must have value addition component so that the export earnings are more. Up till now, there was a tendency among the Indian traders and farmers to dispose of the agricultural goods in their raw form rather than value addition. So there's emphasis in every, not only in agriculture. This foreign trade policy has emphasized that in every sector, value addition will be given prominence. A focus on higher value addition and technology infusion will be a key focus of this foreign trade policy. That is, value addition, it requires good technology. If you are having high-tech technology, if your goods are of high value, that can fetch you more forex, foreign exchange. So the emphasis of this foreign trade policy is to focus on higher value addition and technology infusion. Now, investment in agriculture. This foreign policy, this foreign trade policy also emphasizes on investment in agriculture overseas. That is, in Africa and Latin America. There are vast tracts of fertile lands. Because of low population land ratio, there the population is less. So those land areas are not adequately utilized. So we can make investment in overseas agriculture land that can produce raw material for our manufacturing industries. So the fourth focus of this foreign trade policy is investment in agriculture overseas to produce raw material for the Indian industries. Next focus is low tariff, that is the custom duty will be reduced on inputs and raw materials. See, whatever we export, at times certain inputs and raw materials have to be imported, and if the custom duty tariff is high, those goods land into the country at a higher cost. So basically the input cost increases. As a result, the final cost of manufactured commodity further rises. That will make our exports less competitive. So this foreign trade policy focuses on lower tariffs, that is import duties will be reduced so that the inputs and raw material can be imported cheaply. So that will make our manufactured goods more competitive. Apart from this, this foreign trade policy also emphasizes on development of trade infrastructure. We don't have adequate development of trade infrastructure. We are lacking in testing labs. We are lacking in basically this cold storages. We are lacking in number of packing and basically finishing. We are lacking in adequate transportation also. So all these trade infrastructure, simplification of procedure, all these trade related infrastructure needs to be overhauled. So this foreign trade policy emphasizes development of trade infrastructure and promotion of production and export and provision of production and export incentives. That is, people will be given incentives for promoting production as well as exports. Now, these were the focus areas, these were the objectives of the foreign trade policy. Now, before embarking on this foreign trade policy, we must, this foreign trade policy statement, also discuss certain aspects about multilateral trading system, that is WTO, multilateral trading system and India, and it also discusses the various regional groupings that are coming into existence. They all pose serious challenge for India's export. Once you are, if you are part of the grouping, you will get all the liberalities, that is tariff reduction, everything. But if you are not part of that grouping, you will be imposed with high non-tariff barriers, technical barriers to trade. Number of groupings are coming into existence. We will discuss them. So, multilateral trading system and India, that is WTO. India is a founding member of WTO and believes, India firmly believes that rule-based, non-discriminatory, multilateral trading system is necessary for bringing transparency, equity and fair play in global trade relations. It is essential. There should be a body at apex, at international level, that should control the fair play and equity in the global trade. The multilateral trading system offers the best institutional architecture, that is WTO. It offers the best institutional architecture for developing countries. Basically, in WTO, decisions are based on consensus. The consensus-based decision-making in WTO ensures that even the voice of smallest nation is adequately taken care of. So it is a, basically it is a very democratic institution. India also recognizes the extraordinary contribution that the WTO has already made in with regard to dispute settlement, that is with regard to laying down jurisprudence in those areas where the laws were relatively ambiguous. WTO has played a very important role in dispute settlement as well as in interpreting the laws. An important consideration while framing this foreign trade policy was to ensure that this foreign trade policy is aligned with both India's interests on one side as well as India's commitment under various WTO agreements. That is, both should be taken care of, India's economic interest as well as India's commitment to WTO. This foreign trade policy has been formulated in such a way that it takes into account both these aspects. See, while multilateral trading system need to keep pace with the new developments and updates, basically global, this economic scenario is very dynamic. These changes are taking place at a very fast pace. So in such a scenario, this multilateral trading system need to update itself with new developments, and it should keep on updating its rules. The fact is that there are certain glaring asymmetries in the basically capacities of WTO members to participate and take benefit from international trade. Some of the members are poor developing countries. They are not in a position to take adequate benefit from WTO. Therefore, it is because of this asymmetry, certain countries like US, they are having well-developed infrastructure. They can align with the rules of WTO. But on the other hand, there are certain developing countries which are poor, which cannot match the standards required by the WTO. Basically, this glaring asymmetries in the capacity of WTO members to participate in and benefit from international trade has to be taken account of. Therefore, India will continue to work towards fulfilling its objectives through negotiations under the Doha Round. Basically, Doha Round, the fundamental objective of Doha Round is what? To improve the trading prospects of developing countries. and therefore India has committed itself to keep negotiating and keep working for Doha round. Moreover, over the various, you can see Uruguay round of agreements which form the covered agreements under the Marrakesh arrangement, what we have seen, this various Doha rounds of agreements also have various asymmetries. One of the major asymmetry that can be pointed is basically the methodology that they have prescribed in agreements on agriculture. In agreement on agriculture, the methodology is biased in favor of developed countries and against poor developing countries. One of the methodology that is not acceptable for developing countries is what? That is methodology prescribed in agreement on agriculture for estimating trade distorting support on account of procurement at administered prices for public stocks of food. Now, food security is a major issue in developing countries. We cannot ignore it at any cost. Now, the procurement for the public stock at administered price has to take place to fulfill the needs of people. But the methodology that they have prescribed is not acceptable for the developing countries. As a result, this India along with the developing G33 countries are pursuing negotiation with this regard. Now, basically, this is very important issue vis-a-vis basically for the developing countries, and India has taken up this issue with like-minded members like G33 members for, and basically the group has been able to persuade the WTO members to agree to negotiate a permanent solution to this problem, because ultimately we cannot remain committed to the rules of WTO at the cost of food security of our nation. So the India along with like-minded countries like G33 coalition, they have worked, talked, negotiated, and they have talked to WTO members. They have been able to persuade the WTO members to agree to negotiate to a permanent solution to this problem. Moreover, the agreement on subsidies, now it is very clear, WTO has said this export subsidy will have to go. This is a pointer towards the direction in which the future trade will have to take. The agreement on subsidies and countervailing measures of WTO envisages the eventual phasing out of export subsidies. That is, in future, export subsidies will have to be phased out. This is a pointer to the direction that exports promotion efforts will have to take in future. In future, we cannot rely upon export subsidies. At present time, the government of India is giving export subsidies to the exporters to promote export. But in future, this will have to give way to other structural changes in economy so that the competitiveness of export is increased. So basically, we need to bring about more fundamental changes rather than incentives and subsidies alone, because according to WTO, in future, export subsidies would have to go. Now, apart from this, there are few mega agreements which are coming into existence, and this is also posing a major challenge for India's exporting community. What are these mega agreements? There are three mega agreements that are currently being negotiated, namely Trans-Pacific Partnership, Trans-Pacific TPP. Trans-Atlantic Trade and Investment Partnership, that is TTIP. And third is Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership. These are the three mega agreements. They are evolving and they add a completely new dimension to the global trade practices. These three agreements are adding a totally new dimension to the global trading practices. India is party to RCEP negotiation, Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership. India recognizes the evolution of mega agreements as a significant development in global trade architecture. Why? These agreements, see, why these agreements have come into existence despite the existence of WTO? There are two reasons cited for this. One is the pace at which the WTO proceedings are going on, that is very slow. So some of the members have got fed up because no consensus is there. WTO is a consensus-based organization, and it is very difficult to have consensus because the developed countries and developing countries, they have basically mutual interests clash. Wherever the mutual interest of developing and developed countries clash, there is no consensus. In WTO, the pace of consensus or taking decision is slow. One is this reason. Second reason, some members of WTO have their own personal ambitions. And as a result of these two factors, these regional mega agreements are coming into existence. These agreements are perceived as the consequence of one, stalemate in WTO, and secondly, while some other scholars perceive it as a natural progression of ambition on the part of major players in WTO. Some major players have their personal ambitions. While so far as India is concerned, India's commitment to WTO remains firm. But it must recognize the challenges that will be posed once these mega agreements come into existence. Although India's commitment to WTO is firm, India has to recognize the emerging challenges from the mega agreements under negotiations. These agreements are bound to challenge Indian industry in numerous ways. How? First, these agreements will erode the existing preferences for Indian products in established traditional markets like US and European Union. Presently, they give generalized system of preferences. Zero import duty, they allow some of our product to be exported to these markets. European Union and US, they are offering the basically some liberal practices towards us presently, and these offers may not exist later on. Once these agreements come into existence, these agreements will erode the existing preferences for Indian products that are presently existing in US and European Union. Rather, these will benefit those countries who are members or partners in those agreements. Those mega agreements, those countries which will be the partner, they will reap the benefit of low tariff. India, if it is not a member of those agreement, India could not be able to reap the benefits, and the present benefits like generalized system of preferences, they are importing our products at zero custom duty. This benefit may go away if India is not a member of those agreements. Second, these mega agreements are likely to develop a rule architecture that will place a greater burden on standards of goods and services exported. Once these mega agreements come into existence, the rule-based architecture that will evolve will make India's exports difficult to these countries because they may raise their standards for the goods and services that they will import. So basically, these agreements are likely to develop a rule architecture that will place greater burden of compliance on India's manufacturing and service standards for access to the markets of these countries. Those countries which are the partner countries, if anybody from outside wants to export any goods or services, then for that country there will be a particular standard, and those goods and services should meet those standards. So the exports from India will become difficult. But instead of taking this as a handicap, we must take it as a challenge. We must take it as an opportunity for inducing efficiency and energy in our manufacturing sector. These challenges should be treated as an opportunity to persuade Indian industry to rise to the challenge of higher standards, and basically both in goods and services. Indian industry need to gear up to meet these challenges, for which Government of India will have to create an enabling environment. both business and government will have to work together. Both will have to work together. So this was the first part. In fact, now we are coming on the second part of this phase of foreign trade policy, that is market strategy. Basically, we cannot keep on relying on specific markets. For example, previously most of our exports were destined to Europe and USA. Now, once the slowdown in these countries started, now India's exports started declining. So we had to search for alternatives, and thereafter we found if we have diversified market, then our exports can continue. Even if one region of the world is reeling under recession, the other region may propel the demand, and that will promote the India's exports. In order to put exports on a higher trajectory, India needs a market diversification strategy that is based on changing dynamics of growth in world economy. See, now it is not that the same country continues to grow at a faster rate forever. Now see, the China's economy is coming to slow down. Likewise, Europe and US had been reeling under recession. So, and on the other hand, South America and Africa and Southeast Asia, they are witnessing fast growth. So wherever the economy, where the economic growth is fast, the demand for commodities will be there, and those areas we can promote our exports. So we need to have a diversified market base that is based on changing economics of global dynamics, basically changing dynamics of global economy. In future engagement, now we have changed our focus. What change we have brought about? In future engagement, India will engage with regions and countries that are not only promising markets, but are also major supplier of critical inputs, and they have complementarity with India's economy. Up till now, we were searching the market solely based to export our, to have our exports to those countries. Now we have brought about a change, that is certain countries are also supplier of critical inputs, and our trade relation with those countries should also develop. Ultimately, these inputs are used for manufacturing the commodity, and exports are based on it. So to make the exports competitive, the inputs that are used, they must be available, the assured supply must be there, and secondly, they must be available at a cheaper rate. So as a result, bilateral and regional trading arrangements have gradually become a permanent feature. So now what we are seeing, these bilateral and regional trading arrangement, they are becoming a permanent feature of global trading architecture. You SAR, number of, Mercosur, isn't it? These bilateral and regional trading arrangement, they are become a permanent part of world trade. They have clearly become the rule rather than exception. Now, India has been actively engaging in regional and bilateral trade negotiation with a view to diversifying and expanding its market. India is also trying to become part of various regional and bilateral trading arrangement for its exports, so that it may diversify its exports. As well as this will also ensure India access to the raw materials, intermediates and capital goods. So India is also trying to become a part of various bilateral and regional trading arrangement. Once you become a part of bilateral and regional trading arrangement, within those countries the custom duties are reduced, so export and imports become fast and cheap. Basically, it is important to note that these bilateral and regional trading arrangements are known by various nomenclature. You might have seen preferential trading agreement, free trade agreement, regional trading agreement, comprehensive economic partnership, comprehensive economic cooperation agreement. You might have heard broad-based trade and investment agreement, BTR. They are different. they are not same. You must note it, they are different. Basically, BTI, bilateral trade and investment agreement, comprehensive economic partnership agreement, comprehensive economic cooperation agreement on one hand, free trade agreement, preferential trade agreement and regional trade agreement on the other, like this. Preferential trading agreement, free trade agreement and regional trading agreement. On the other, comprehensive economic cooperation agreement, comprehensive economic partnership agreement and BTR, bilateral trade and investment agreement. Now these agreements are confined, if you become a member of this, if your bilateral or regional trading arrangement is preferential trade agreement or free trade agreement or regional trade agreement. Here the concessions are given to the member countries only with respect to trade in goods. Whatever countries which have concluded preferential trade agreement or free trade agreement or regional trade agreement among them, those countries will give each other preferences or relaxation in custom duty vis-a-vis export and import of goods. Whereas in case of these comprehensive economic or comprehensive economic partnership or BTR, in this case the member countries gives preferences to each other not only in case of trade in goods but also services, investment, intellectual property. That is, it is much more broad based. Here the member countries will benefit each other only by way of lower tariff in export and import of goods. But in this case, they will not only, these agreements not only cover the trade in goods but also in
services,
investment, intellectual property. So these are much more broad based, while basically these are limited to goods. So there is difference between them. So now India's focus is more on having these agreements which are more broad based. They also attract investment. Now let us come on to region, India's trade with North America. One by one we will discuss our policy vis-a-vis all the countries of the world. Now first we will start with North America. Understood. Basically, North America, this includes USA,
Canada,
Mexico. Basically, it also includes the Central American countries, but here they are not included because our trade with them is almost negligible. 7 Central American countries are also there. Now, broadly, our trade in North America is confined to these 3 countries. Now USA is the most important market because it is the largest export destination for India's merchandise goods. Matlab, India largest exporter, India exports maximum to USA. It is the largest export destination for Indian goods. USA is most important for India, not only in this region, globally also, because that is the largest export destination. In fact, basically in 2013-14, 12.5% of India's total exports were destined for
USA.
They were targeted for USA. Out of total exports, 12.5% exports of the countries were directed towards USA in 2013-14. Basically, the size of bilateral trade in merchandise goods, bilateral trade between India and
USA,
the size of bilateral trade in merchandise goods
in 2013-14 was $62 billion. US billion, $62 billion. But if we add services also, then total bilateral trade in goods and services was approximately $100 billion. Huge. Basically, the size of bilateral trade in merchandise goods is $62 billion, and basically if we add services also, then it becomes, bilateral trade becomes $100 billion. US is one of the most prominent traditional market for India, for Indian products and services. Basically, it is by way of export to US that we have raised the standard of our goods and services that are exported. US is the most important traditional market for India's products and services, and this country has helped Indian producers in evolving their capacities both in merchandise and service product standards. Basically, because to export to USA you need to have good standard, and by way of exporting commodities to USA we have upgraded our standard in both goods and services. The recent macroeconomic data shows that US economy is doing well, better than what was anticipated. US economy is doing well with a growth rate of 3% per annum. Therefore, US is going to continue to be the sheet anchor for India's exports, because US is the largest export destination for India's goods. And if US economy is picking up, that means India's export to US will continue to increase. At the same time, there are certain challenges. Basically, relating to areas such as intellectual property rights. Yes, it is a cause of concern. I will discuss it elaborately while discussing pharma. In US, the 50% of its growth is due to innovations, the innovations and basically research and development. And whatever drugs they innovate, they give patent for it. No other person can, country can, or person can manufacture the same drug for a specific time interval. But this patent regime for pharmaceutical in India is slightly more rigid than that of WTO and US. So those innovations are not having patentability in India, and this is the issue that we'll discuss in pharma, and US is taking up with India's authorities. According to WTO, only 3 conditions must be fulfilled for any innovation to get intellectual property right or patent. That is, it must be new, it must be capable of industrial application, and one more condition is there. But India's Section 3D of Indian Patent Amendment Act 2005, it has added 4th condition also, that is enhanced efficacy. As a result, India has raised the standard of intellectual property rights, and this US says India must align its intellectual property rights law according to the world standards. Now, what is world standard? The WTO standards are based on US. Now, US standard cannot be taken to be the world standard. We have our own standards, and trade related intellectual property rights, WTO itself enables a country. WTO merely defines the bare minimum conditions that must be fulfilled. We are adding one more condition. For any innovation in the field of pharma to have patentability in India, it must fulfill all the 4 conditions. And this 4th condition is very difficult to be fulfilled, and therefore we don't provide patent. And when we don't provide patent, the generic drug manufacturers continue to operate and manufacture drugs at very low price. Moreover, US also puts allegation that India resorts to compulsory licensing in some cases, although this is not true. So there are certain challenges relating to areas like intellectual property rights, immigration policies of US government, basically labor and skill related policies of US government. Number of issues are there, but all are being discussed. An important aspect of Indo-US economic relationship for India include resolution of issue relating to social security contribution. It is very important issue, and this issue has been taken up by Indian officials with American officials several times. What is this? The issue of social security contribution by Indian workers in US. Through basically, this must be resolved through early conclusion of totalization agreement. We want to have a social security act. There should be a social security pact between India and US. What happens? India's immigrants who go to USA and work over there, basically India's IT professional and other workers, they are living in US, isn't it? In fact, it is said it is India's workers and India's IT professional who account for almost 50% of employment based on US green card. Based 50% of employment based on H-1B visa. 50% of L-1 professional visa are used by Indian technocrats or professionals. So these people go to US and work over there. Now these workers have to make yearly contributions of about $2 to $4 billion. They have to make yearly contribution of about $2 to $4 billion towards US social security system. Now, according to US norms, basically these workers need to complete at least 10 years of stay in US to become eligible to enjoy the benefits of this social security investment. They should at least stay for 10 years so that they can enjoy the benefit of these social security investment or contribution that they have made. But large number of workers going from India, they go for a period of less than 10 years. So what happens? They end up contributing money to the US social security system, but they never become eligible to reap the benefits of this system. Nor this money is refunded, nor they are able to use the benefits. So what happens? This money goes in vain. As a result, India wants a social security pact. They are paying so much money to US social security system and they are not reaping the benefit. Why? You need to stay for 10 years in US to reap the benefits of social security system. But these most of the workers come back to India even before completing 10 years. So whatever contribution they have made, they never make any use. They are never able to utilize those contributions. So India wants a social security pact with US that will exempt Indian workers who are on H-1B visa from contributing to social security system, because from on H-1B visa a person can stay only for 6 years. Since he has been given right to stay for 6 years, he cannot enjoy the benefits of social security contribution, because only those people can have the benefits of social security system who at least stay there for 10 years. So government of India says at least for those workers we must have social security pact, as they are not eligible for refunds because H-1B visa is maximum for 6 years. So they will never be able to enjoy the benefits of contributions towards social security system. Now, as per US laws, basically, but US is not ready. Why? US says it does not have the legislation mandate. Basically, US has a law that it can conclude a social security pact only with those countries where at least 50% of population is covered under social security net. And US says in India, less than 50% country population is covered by social security net, and therefore US cannot conclude a totalization agreement or social security pact with India. US says it does not have the legislative mandate to negotiate a totalization agreement with such countries that have less than half of its population under social security cover. So what will happen? So Indian officials went over there with their total report. Now a team of officials from India visited US from the Ministry of Overseas Indians, certain expert group. Gaye, bole hum is paar dekho karke aayenge pact. We will ensure US social security officials that in India more than 50% population is covered under social security net, and once we convince them, they will have to have a social security pact with India, and thereafter the Indian workers going to US for less than 10 years will not have to contribute to social security system of US. So a team of officials went to US to negotiate a social security pact. This team gave a presentation to US social security officials and they cited schemes such as Rashtriya Swasthya Bima Yojana. We are having Rashtriya Swasthya Bima Yojana. We are having Atal Pension Yojana. We are having Employment Provident Fund. We are having various old age and accident cover scheme. मर जाओ तो इतने रुपए मिलते हैं, टूट जाए रुक टांग तो इतने रुपए मिलते हैं, तो उसकी हमारे यहां तो यूएस ने कहा देखो ऐसा है, दीज स्कीम्स विल नॉट बी यूज्ड टू कवर द सोशल सिक्योरिटी नेट, दीज स्कीम्स कैन नॉट बी टेकन टू कवर द सोशल सिक्योरिटी नेट बिकॉज दीज आर वॉलंटरी, दीज आर नॉट मैंडेटरी, यू शुड मैंडेटरी गिव देम द सोशल सिक्योरिटी, दीज आर वॉलंटरी. Outrightly rejected. The team argued, the basically Indian team argued, if we count the population, that if we count the population covered under all such social security schemes, then it will easily cover more than 50% population of India under social security net. But this claim was rejected by Washington, as these Indian officials were told by them that most of these schemes cited by the team could not be considered social security, as these were voluntary, not mandatory. आ गए मुठा. अरे उनका एक स्टैंडर्ड है, बेसिकली यहाँ अलग स्टैंडर्ड है, हाइजीन के स्टैंडर्ड्स भी होते हैं ना, बेसिकली हर चीज के स्टैंडर्ड होते हैं. नाउ लेट अस टेक अ 5 मिनट्स ब्रेक, देन वी विल कंटिन्यू.